Welcome back to Let's Interactively Play Steve Jackson Sorcery. This is a Let's Play where you get to choose at the end the choices presented, and that will be a majority vote going forward into the next video. My voice is off. I'm recording this probably against my better judgment, but I figured I might as well get an episode in case I actually get full-blown laryngitis again. Yeah. So get one in now, and knocking on wood, I'm not incapacitated for the next week or two. I'm going to try to get a video out on Monday night, the same as usual, unless my voice is screwed up. So get your votes in by I don't know, midnight, starting Sunday, Eastern Standard Time, if at all possible. So you have, like, basically Thursday, Friday, so you have about 2 days and a few hours to get your votes in. If I don't put one out on Monday, then I'll count all votes, of course. I'm going to try to keep this a little bit short to save my voice, so we'll see if it's a feasible thing. Right, so, yeah, the room we're in is nothing but a trap, and we walk straight into it. We looked at a whole bunch of things, and, yeah. I'm thinking this is a timed thing, because the way you had to describe every little action is kind of, you know, not typical for this game. I mean, you had to separately open the chest, and then, as a separate action, look in it. So I'm thinking this is something timed, and not because I lifted the box and turned it over. So, majority vote was cast a spell. I don't know what kind of spell, but let's see what we can do. If you hear that, it's because I'm sliding the mic up so I can either cough or sniffle. So. What can we do in this circumstance? Teleportation. Very unpredictable, but it's an option. Create wind. Not sure what that could, what good that will do. Where are we? A greenish cloud. Well, it could actually blow the greenish cloud of gas away. But we'd still have to get out. I'm kind of leaning against that, against teleportation, because teleportation is, well, you don't get to choose where you go. I'm not sure if we could teleport into a wall or what, so. If we blow away the poison gas, then we can get to work on finding a way out of this place in, more in our leisure. Force field. Not sure if that would stop poison gas. Maybe. Excuse me. Oh, let's see. Explosions. Maybe blow open the portcullis. Not sure. Cause strength. Yeah, let's do the wind. Okay. I'm tired too. What's the other thing? How? Find safe passage, because that requires a turn, in which case the gas will be upon us, so. Let's create wind, see if that works. Consulting the stars, you bind the magic, lifting the gale horn and blowing a loud note. The mighty gale swirls, or howls actually, about the room, blowing the poison gas out to the portcullis. The clean air tastes sweet. You approach the portcullis. Okay. Yeah, I'm not gonna shout for help. Look over the. Now we have an option for the trapdoor. Again. Looking over the gate, you can see it descends from a hidden panel in the ceiling, but you can't see any switches or levers on the walls either side. Oh, I have some tea. That actually feels good. Let's open the trapdoor. You tug excitedly at the trapdoor, only to find it is a fake, merely painted on the floor of the room and then set with a ring. You fall back in some irritation. Oh my god. Lift the gate? The gate. They're talking about the portcullis. In your healthy condition, you have no trouble lifting the gate. It rolls up and you hold it aloft before diving under it. Alright, good. Thanks, guys. We escaped that one. You pick yourself up from the floor and brush yourself down. The gas from the chamber dissipates into the air of the courtyard. No one seems to have noticed your escape. We don't need to eat food. We're actually full, so we're going to move on. Which way now? So we've been to these areas. Let's check out Nylock shop. Hope this isn't a trap as well. You enter a trade post of some kind. A bald woman with one eye leans on a counter flanked by shelves stacked with goods and trinkets. At the moment, she's talking to a finely dressed traveler. The merchant Nylock glances up as you enter, then returns to her bargaining. Steal something. Regard, Nylock. You regard the trader for a moment. Nylock leans over a ledger, and she looks like she is held that same pose for 100 years or more. To say she is not showing her visitor much respect would be an understatement. Really. Listen and wait. The merchant is shaking her head, not meeting the eyes of the traveler. Listen, I do want what you have, but if I buy it at that price, the Archmage will have my head. With all due respect, of course. I see. I must give this some thought, rumbles the traveler. Keep listening. You hover, listening, but the trader behind the counter has noticed you. Well? She demands. And what do you want? The man at the counter seems to notice you for the first time. Something about the man seems familiar. It would appear the feeling is mutual. You! The man gasps. Who is it? Indeed. You reply, with no idea who the man is. I saw you in the darkness, the man murmurs, when the gate turned to fire and the goblins were destroyed. Oh, back in Kare. Could it be Vic? Supposedly Vic is here. Let's think back. You cast your mind back, but can remember nothing of the man's face, though you recall the night to which he is referring. The man interrupts your thoughts with a laugh. You don't know me? You must have seen sketches of my face, at least, on the walls and pamphlets that covered Kare. Yep, I was right. The man puffs out his chest. I am Vic Senshale, first noble of the city port of Thieves, and you, I think, are the Annalander. Nylock lifts her head briefly. You know this stranger? Vic grabs you by the shoulder. Why, my dear friend here is the reason I'm first noble. She aided me in defeating the marsh goblin hordes that threatened the city on the day of my ascension. Says Nylock. She goes back to her writing in her ledger again. She's not listening, you observe. Nylock isn't. She has gone back to her ledger, recording and computing figures. Vic explodes. What kind of reception is this for an ambassador? I'm busy, Nylock responds, and I'm not a diplomat. Vic huffs. Tea. And how is Kare now? You ask. Changing, Vic answers. The first thing I did was remove the council. Amazing how much more efficient things can be when there's only one voice in charge. And a businessman's voice at that. He flashes a smile at Nylock, but her one eye is looking elsewhere. You can really start making the kind of changes you'd like to see. You still use werewolves? You ask. Nylock looks up sharply. He shushes you. Keep it down. You want to give away trade secrets? The esteemed Archmage, he says, glancing at Nylock, merely wishes to know how to acquire such a disciplined force. I'm sure it's a lucrative deal. For everyone! He laughs, then looks at you shrewdly. I'm doing well. Really? I don't want to push my luck with this guy. Thanks to me. True, he nods. Vic knows a deal when he sees it. You not only saved the city, you're the one who helped me rise to first noble. So what are you interested in? Your aid. You reply. Interesting. He replies. Let's hear you. Sorcerer Spike? Have we heard of this? I need to get into... Oh! I thought there was a weapon. Get the Sorcerer Spike. I need to get into the Sorcerer Spike. Do you now? He replies with interest. Well, I don't know any that go in there except for the Birdman, and I can't see how you persuade them to help you. Hmm. There isn't a door? You and your doors, he replies with a smile. There's the throbbing doors. Throbin, actually. Or something like that. But they're guarded somehow. You won't get them open. No one goes that way. Throbin, Nylock corrects him, not looking up. You had half forgotten she was listening in. I thought she wasn't paying attention. He gives a wide smile and claps you on the shoulder. A pleasure, as always. His smile couldn't be more insincere. He goes over to a pile of papers and begins sorting through them. Nylock is unimpressed. I guess we're done with that. That wasn't very helpful. Ask Nylock about her goods. You cough politely. What kind of goods are traded here, you ask. What? Nylock looks up. Oh, you still here? I have some questions. Good for you, she responds, picking her teeth with a handy rat bone. What do you do here in Manpeng? What do you suppose I do? She replies, waving her hand around the shop. There cannot be many to buy such wares. She grumbles a little. Well, you're right. This is a warehouse, not a shop, though I'll take your gold if you wave it at me. I coordinate trade for the Archmage. What kind of trade? All of it. How did you lose your eye? It fell behind my bed. How did it come out? You continue. A guard did me the honor of detaching it for me, she replies. I've never been able to satisfactorily thank him for it, although believe me, I have tried. That seems a harsh punishment. Does it? Where do you come from to say that? But she does not appear to want an answer to her question. What can you tell me about the Archmage? He employs me. So you've met him? Of course I haven't met him. He's probably dead, but I didn't say that. I just handled the trading. She pauses to scratch. Now, do you want anything else? I want to buy something. Good for you, she glowers. You browse around her stock. What do we have? Blood candles? Brass pendulum? Compass? Golden egg? Provisions? I don't know. If we need any of the first four things. Buy provisions for 8 gold? You sell some strange things, you observe. Go to the market if you want the usual stuff, she replies. Don't bother me about it. Vic is fussing around at the back of the shop. I don't know, should I buy some provisions? I only have 30 gold. I guess I should have asked Vic for gold. His information was not very helpful. I'm gonna buy nothing then. I will buy nothing, Nylock shrugs. I am leaving, you assure her. Splendid. Vic salutes you. Be seeing you, he grumbles. Two new clues. A clue. The Archmage may be dead. Some rumors say the Archmage is long dead. The Throbin Doors. The central tower of the Archmage is guarded by the fearsome Throbin Doors. If I'm saying that right. Alright, let's go out. You step out into the courtyard once more. The fountain trickles and spits delightfully. I don't need to eat food. Which way now? Alright, the only way left is this one. What do we have? Did the roof collapse over here or something? Dark hallway. Looks like the way out. At the far end of the courtyard is a gloomy hallway. It seems like a strange addition to the otherwise clean merchant's quarter. It goes down. Or out. It goes down to this door. This goes back up. I don't know to where. It looks like that's a ladder down. Interesting. You emerge into a small, dirt-filled room. There's an untidy pile of timber in the center and a door at the far end. Look at the far door. You cross the room and rattle the handle of the far door, but it doesn't turn. Is it locked? The door is heavy wood, tightly joined, and yet from between its planks a thick oil seems to ooze. Most likely this door is closed with good reason. Search the room. As far as you can see, the only thing in the room is the pile of wood in the middle of the floor. The timber looks half-rotten. It is covered in curious black splotches. Set it on fire. Huh. Search the pile. You shift some timber, hoping to find something of interest. You discover only bare flagstones beneath. You move a large, rough-edged piece of wood and are rewarded by a splinter in your finger. You think nothing of it, but then, a moment later, you start to feel dizzy. Great. You raise your hand and see the same black splotches that covered the wood spreading across your palms. This must be some kind of disease. Look at my pack for a cure. Searching your pack frantically, you pull out the blimberry potion. Will it heal this particular disease? Let's pray instead. You close your eyes and raise a prayer to Korga. You can feel your hands numbing to the black splotches as the black splotches grow. Are they going to fall off? But then the splotches begin to glow as the balm of your graceful god touches them. They recede, then disappear. Feeling and strength flows back into your hands. You are lucky. Apparently I can't touch that door. But there's nothing else here to do. You try the door handle once more. Kick down the door. One good kick and the door flies open. The far door opens onto a staircase heading downwards. Okay. I didn't think it was going to be that easy. I thought I was going to get diseased again. The stairs. You step onto the top step of a flight of stairs that runs down into the darkness below. Well, apparently I can't go down these stairs. But I can go down... Unless this is a representation of that. Not sure. Halfway down. The smell grows worse with every downward step you take. Lovely. The bottom of the steps. I can hear my own heartbeat. The smell is fetid down here. What is this place? A low doorway is set in the wall. Listen. Behind the door you hear shuffling and snuffling and scraping. What buried horrors lie beyond the door? Okay. Well, there's not much else place to go, so let's check it out. You stride into the underground room to be stopped short by a chaotic scene. Inside the cramped chamber are more than a dozen grotesque creatures clambering all over each other. What the hell? I wish I could make this larger. Look at that thing! It's just a head and feet. Reminds me of the Wolverton. Basil Wolverton, I believe. Drawings from like the 70s. Or might even be 60s. Look at the creatures. The creatures resemble goblins in the way a wax puddle resembles a candlestick. All have been cursed and stunted with horrendous growths and changes. One has a large bulbous head, puffy like a sack of potatoes. Another has hands growing all over its torso, while a third seems to lack any bones at all, and flops and rolls around the room. Greet the creatures. I don't think they're going to be... friendly. So what are these? Genetic aberrations? Or someone's been doing experiments on them or something like that? Look at the room. It's hard to see clearly through the faded creatures, but there seems to be a door on the far side of the room. Probably shouldn't, but greet them. You step forward to greet one of the creatures. You notice her tongue is sneaking out of her mouth and coils twice around her neck. Who are you? She asks. Are you looking for the vault? I'm not going to threaten them. What is the vault? You ask. You must be looking for the vault, the mutant answers, rolling her head in its socket. No one comes down here. The other mutants lumber towards you. A few more circle around as though trying to approach you sideways. Oh my god. Are they trying to flank me or something? Oh, yeah. My tea is finally cool enough. Oh, yeah. That's awesome. Alright. I mean you no harm. The mutant seems taken aback. Her tongue has retreated, at least. You lie. What happened to you? The long-tongued goblin is silent. Another steps forward, one with small mouths in place of eyes. All three mouths speak at once with jarring harmony. We exist at the Archmage's pleasure. We are his little toys. They say he searches for the secrets of life itself. I will free you, you declare boldly. But every goblin stiffens at your words. You question the Archmage? We serve his pleasure. The crowd begins to advance, muttering threats. Offer them something? You open up your pouch, showing them your hefty supply of gold. I don't have that much. But the long-tongued goblin laughs. Gold? Can you eat gold? Does it help you to walk, or smile, or laugh? Then what do you want? You ask. Nothing you can give, the mutant replies. You cannot remake what has been made. I'm not going to threaten them. You take a step back. I will go. You turn to leave with the click of teeth at your back. The click of teeth at my back. You slip gratefully out of the mutant's chamber and close the door behind you. You can hear the mutant snuffling and honking behind the door. Well, maybe I should have ran for the door. Kind of lost that option a little bit in. Back up? I don't think there's much back there. You climb quickly back up the steps. You gasp with relief, slamming the door to the mutant staircase shut once more. The far door opens onto a staircase heading downwards. Alright. You return up the gloomy hallway. You step out into the courtyard once more. You hear the tramp of guard boots past the front of the building. Which way now? Out? I'm not sure. You return to the east side of the bustling square. The buildings on the eastern edge are a little more ramshackle. The arch to the merchant's building leads away here. An alley runs past it. A pillory sits to the north of here. The sun disappears, heading toward the horizon. Have I looked at this stuff? A prisoner stoops, half asleep, inside the stocks. Is it the alley? Glancing down the alley, you see a distant touch of smoke. Some kind of fire? You could cross the square or explore the fringes. Oh, I guess maybe we haven't been here. Let's go this way, the alley. You make your way along the alleyway. A lane leads off. The wind picks up as the evening draws on. I need to go sleep and rest. Look down the lane. Looking down the lane, you see a large tavern, with plenty of noise coming from it. Time to continue. I apologize for my voice, guys. The tea is helping a little bit, but not that much. Let's check out the tavern. Oh, yeah. A sign hangs outside the tavern door. This is the Bony Hand. The Bony Hand. To enter the tavern, you are forced to duck under the low doorframe. The whole building seems to have sunk at least a foot into the ground, either from age, neglect, or both. You're probably safe from the guard patrols in here. Most of the guard are merchants or other visitors to Mampang. You see a good number of messengers and clerks returning from far-flung eastern areas of the Archmage's growing kingdom. The crown has extended his grip across a wide area, much of it normally occupied by proud cultures who would fight back if it were not for the artifact's controlling powers. Now it takes nearly as many bureaucrats as soldiers to maintain it all. What's so funny? There are several tables, both occupied and empty, in a little space at the bar. Let's talk to some people here. Oh, I don't want to play Swindler's Stones or whatever the hell it's called. You walk over Swindler's Stones? Something like that. Swindle Stones. You walk over to a group of black elves clustered around a table. Empty cups are scattered on the floor around them, and a dagger sticks out of the table. They're dressed in armor, though they seem to be relaxed. Mercenaries. One points at you as you pass. Look at this skinny one. Bet you can barely even lift that sword. The guard's going to the wolves, I tell you. The others laugh at your expense. I told you guys not to laugh at me. I'll laugh along, though. You meekly laugh along, which only increases their amusement. The black elf continues to insult you. Yeah. This is against my better judgment as well, but how about a nice little barroom brawl? Hit him. You swing out and land a solid blow on his jaw. He staggers back, then snarls and leaps forward. Raise your fists. In a fist fight, damage is lower and power refreshes more quickly. Sorry, guys. Just talking is making this worse. So we got block, jab, clout, bash, thump, punch, or pulverize. Damage is lower and power refreshes more quickly. Let's thump him. Oh, we didn't do anything. I kind of wasted power there. You're ugly now, but we'll look even worse once I'm done with you, the black elf growls. Raising his fists. You swing a punch at his temple while the others shout and lay down bets on the fight. He holds his fist to his face. To his face. The black elf chuckles with pleasure at escaping unharmed. The muscles in his arms tighten. The gathered crowd chatters with excitement. Alright, let's block. The black elf's lips are a tight line and he advances. You're slower than sap, he says. The black elf steps back around an onlooker. Let's cloud him. Whoosh. You set your stance. You leap forward, attempting to headbutt him. He wheezes with pain, but he lifts his guard to cover himself. The black elf growls. I'm gonna bash him. Bash. But he's weak, man. Got him good that time. You maintain the momentum. You shove him backwards into a wooden pillar. The black elf can do nothing to stop your blow. A tooth topples from the black elf's mouth. Come where I can reach you, he growls. Let's cloud him. Oh, he got that one. Oh, he got me good, too. The black elf gets the upper hand. Sweeping wide leaves you open, and he charges with considerable strength, knocking you back. He feints left, banging into a table. Bash him. The crowd's approval bolsters you. You grab him by the scruff of his neck, then knee him in the groin. Nice. He ducks quickly to one side. I should have blindfolded myself to make it fair, he says. The black elf rubs his arm ruefully. He grinds his teeth. Hey, you're almost done, boy. See if I can bash him. Good. That's it. You launch at him again. You swing hard and low. You trip over the black elf. You trip the black elf. Actually, I trip over him. Give him one final blow to the head as he lies on his back. He waves you off, admitting defeat. 3 stamina lost. Brilliant boxing. The elf turns over the table as he collapses, upsetting the drinks. The watching crowd are too delighted by the fight to mind. Search his body. Nice! More gold. Maybe I will go back and get some provisions from that one-eyed lady. You quickly pat down the fallen elf's body, and his companions make no move to stop you. But all you find are a few gold pieces. I believe it's 7. You leave them without a word. They cheer your fine fisticuffs. Dice table, probably not going to play. Huh? You see a few tables where many are hunched over their swindle stones. You see an unkempt merchant alone at a table waiting for a game. You approach her table. Looking for a game, you ask? I am, but I only play for money. I'm gonna shake my head. I got time for that. You decline the game and leave the table. She shouts for a new opponent, her words slurred. Huh. Maybe she was drunk. She might have been an easy opponent. I don't know. There are several tables, both occupied and empty, in a little space at the bar. Let's, pull up to the bar first, I guess. You force through the crowd until you reach the bar, which is covered in gouges and old bloodstains. The innkeeper is a scowling dwarf who spends more time shouting at customers to wait their turn than actually serving. After an age, he comes over to you. Ale is a gold piece. Do you want something else? Hold on, guys. I need to ask you a few questions. Can't hear you, the bartender shouts back. What do you want? Information. He snorts. Here's your information. A cup of ale is one gold piece. That is all you will get from me. Clear? He turns to serve a burly orc. Food? The bartender turns back to you. 6 gold pieces from some dry meat. I also got a stew for 4. Stew. He scoops a piping hot bowl from a vat under the counter. What is it? The bartender shakes his head. Nope, didn't catch that. What, you ask, pointing at the stew. What, the bartender returns. What, you demand, pointing harder. Yes, but what, the bartender demands, increasingly annoyed. What, you demand, pointing furiously. Oh, the bartender finally notices your pointing finger. It's stew. I'll take it. What happened? I just ate it, I guess. Okay. You hand over your gold and wolf down the stew. It's delicious. It satisfies your hunger. That's good. I figured, thought we'd add it to rations, but I guess you can't stow away stew, right? You nod an acknowledgement of sorts and move away from the bar. Let's go to this empty table. Because really, that's all else to do, except for have ale, play Swindlestones, or leave. You find a corner table and sit down. Look at the other drinkers. You survey the room, marveling at how such a jolly place exists in Manpang. The rest does you well, and you feel a little stronger for it. Good! We get the rest of our strength back. Stamina. A stranger walks up to your table, their face completely obscured by a plain yellow cloth. May I sit? They ask, voice muffled. Please. You say, gesturing to the seat. The stranger bows a fraction, then sits. My thanks. It has been a tiring journey. I move very slowly, you understand. Away from the bar, it is quiet enough to talk, even to this soft-spoken figure. Why is that? I am very old, the priest replies. I would have died 100 years ago if the Sun Serpent's light were not keeping me alive. Huh. I think I killed the Sun Serpent? Oh no, I think the Sun Serpent was the one I couldn't find. He makes a sign with his hand, moving his fingers in a coiling flash fashion. How do you worship? I give worship to the serpent, thanking it for the boon of the sun's light. I also pray to it for aid. We've got a lot of choices here. Why is your face covered? So I am not blinded by the glory of the Sun Serpent. To gaze upon its light would be too much for the eyes of a mere mortal. Does the serpent answer your prayers? You ask with a pointed look. I believe it does, the priest says, and falls silent. Well, this was most edifying, the priest says as he stands. Bowing once more, he leaves. But you are done resting. You get to your feet once more. That was interesting. I'd like to go up here, but we don't have the option, so we'll go outside. You head back onto the path and back to the square. You make your way back into the alley. Darkness closes in. You should find a suitable spot to sleep. You would do well to find somewhere safe to rest. Well, I just left some place that has a room upstairs. Maybe here? You follow the road to a junction where a collection of nestled, winding alleys lead away. The moon climbs the sky, filling the world with thin silver light. Peering down them, hints at a maze of twisting paths and shadowy nooks. There's a small fire here with which a few figures sit glumly around. The people gathered here have a cluster of tents to one side, along with packs of gear. A small fire burns in a dugout pit, and they sit around it, chatting over a bubbling stew. The alleys are a rat's nest of buildings and winding streets. They seem to go on forever, and yet curve immediately away out of sight. A rat scurries up to your foot, then stands nearby, boldly staring. The buildings surrounding you are old and poorly built, in stark contrast to the martial efficiency of the rest of Mampang. Most are sagging and leaning, but you can see shadows moving in the windows. Despite the grim setting, people still live here. You approach the fire, but something about your appearance must be foreboding, as no one will talk to you. I'll spend the night here, then. You put your pack against one side of the street, a little way out of the circle of firelight. The group around you pay you no attention. At least you have eaten once already today. So we don't need to eat again. Hopefully my stuff isn't stolen. You get comfortable and rest. Oh, that's right, I spent 4 gold on the stew. What is left of the night is restless with vivid dreams, and all the while you hear distant laughter from the east. Alleys of East Mampang. During the day you gained some gold, +3, and found 3 new clues. The Archmage is still looking for you. Okay, we have all our stamina and gold, and rations. You wake next morning to find the narrow street still in darkness. You get quickly to your feet once more. Let's explore the alleys or follow the road. Several alleys lead off from here. The East Road. You pass by the alleys and follow the road as it heads towards the rising wall of Mampang. After a while, the path opens out into a stony clearing. The sun breaks over the eastern wall. Guards walk this way and that across the space. Look at the flagstones. The flagstones of this square are smoothed and worn as though by torrential rain. Across the square is a low wall set with a door. The guards do not seem to be guarding it, but none are going anywhere near it either. The people in the square are moving this way and that, seemingly without purpose. They all seem quite concerned and busy, however. You could elbow your way through the strange crowds filling the square. All right, let's do that. I hear kids. You cross into the middle of the small square. Guards move this way and that across the flagstones. The early morning sun makes the air glow. In one corner of the square is a tent from which rich smells are rising. The food seller has a low tent with a cooking stove. A few of the square's wandering populace pause by it to eat before continuing on their endless circuits. This is not a good place to hang around. The door here, I don't even know. Alright, the food tent. The air moves a little around you, still icy but fresh. You approach the small kitchen. To one side, a long table is crowded with people eating their meals. The chef bustles through the kitchen. Hungry? Seems the cook is serving boiled tortoise for 7 gold. The meat is served in half of a shell, which is mottled from the heat. I think we're okay with food. I'll ask about it anyway. You ask about the boiled tortoise. You would not believe how hard these are to catch. They only come out at night, so I have to fumble around in the grass looking for them. Half the time I end up stepping on them by accident. Still kills them, though, so I shouldn't complain. You attract the attention of the chef. Yes? He demands. You want to eat? What lies beyond the east wall? You ask. The chef seems to shiver. Magic. And lots of it. It's wading from the shallows into a lake. Don't go. What is this part of the city? The Eastern Square, he replies. But it's more like a holding pen. What are the people here all doing? Here? Eating? Out in the square, you mean? They're waiting. Waiting for what? To be needed. If you watch long enough, you'll see them being called away. You ask a lot of questions, the chef observes through narrowed eyes. Must make you hungry. He waves the food at his stove. Something to eat? You decide against eating. The chef shrugs. Suit yourself, he says. Well, You return to the middle of the small square. Guards patrol the area. A pair of sightmasters in deep discussion cross the square, but they do not notice you amongst the other guards. Clearly, life in Manpang has lessened their powers of sight. They disappear into an alley mouth. This is not a good place to hang around. Let's check by the door, then. You make your way to the far wall, into which is set a low door. You turn to see that the guards in square have noticed you, but your disguise seems to reassure them. You are not stopped. You feel an incredible energy rising from behind the door, as though something was chained there. You try the door. It is clearly latched against the wind and not locked. Which way now? Magic. Look at all these towers. Jeez. We're not going to go to all these towers, are we? You step through the door into a curiously quiet area of stone. Okay, this is stone. I thought this was water. Low towers rise from a dark pool of icy-looking water. Okay, it's water. With paths snaking across it from one side to another, the whole place is worn and ruined. What is this place? It looks like no part of Manpang you have not yet encountered. The air itself is somehow different. There's a tension here. The air itself feels tightened, as though the world is stretched thin here. A taut drum skin pulled over a too wide frame. It feels like as though the tiniest step might unleash a powerful rupture. You look up for the stars but can find nothing. The starlight seems to bend and divert before it can reach you, as though being funneled away. What is happening in this place? A few clouds drift across the sky. The water looks cold as ice, and has no reflections. It's as cold as ice. Look at the towers. Some of the towers rise to the height of trees, while others have been cut down, and others are nothing but circles of rubble. Smoke rises from some, while others crackle with gentle light and energy. This place is clearly buzzing with power. You could explore deeper, or escape back to the relative safety of Manpang. I would leave this for an, I know you guys would, you're all gonna say to explore, so this is no option. Alright, I'm coughing more. Hold on. You leave the shade of the wall and follow the stepping stones out across the water. Everywhere the signs of ruin abound. Weeds crack the stones, turret roofs and buttresses have collapsed into heaps. Why has the Archmage allowed such ruin? Surely the rumors of his death cannot be true? As the morning moves on, the wind begins to rise. You reach the base of a stone tower, with a curved archway at its base. The path splits around it, but you must keep moving. No! Oh, I hit that. I didn't mean to do that. You are crossing the stepping stones over the dangerous waters once more. The path rounds a tower to the north and splits again. Up ahead is a tower, surrounded by thick mud. South of here is another tower, perhaps coated over with some kind of black carapace. Is this like this black stuff we found in that on that door? And the broken timbers? The disease or whatever? You reach out and gently touch the black surface of the tower by the wall. It is hard to touch, smooth and cool. If there was even a doorway here, you cannot make it out. Huh. Smash it. With what? Yeah, I'm gonna leave it for a vote here. My concern with smashing the black coating is back in the previous, episodes when we hacked at something with our sword, we lost, like, a plus to it. Like, a plus two sword turned into plus one. Stuff like that. So I'm concerned about smashing the black coating will be with my sword and I'll lose a plus to it. So that's my thing there. I could cast a spell, which would probably be useful, or I could make a move and try one of these other towers. So let me know what you guys think I should do. Should we smash the black coating somehow? Unknown how? Cast a spell or make a move to another location in here? Thanks so much for watching. See you next time, and always seek adventure. See you next week.